Good evening from Los Angeles. My name is Yasuko Uchida. I was newly appointed as director of the Japan Foundation Los Angeles from this September. So nice to meet you. First of all, please let me tell you about the Japan Foundation. We were established in 1972 under the auspices of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Now we have 25 offices in 24 countries, including two in the US, New York and Los Angeles. The Japan Foundation Los Angeles develops a wide range of programs and grants aimed at supporting Japanese language education and promoting Japanese arts and culture, Japanese studies, and so on. Today is World Food Day. It was established in 1979 to promote global awareness and action for those who suffer from hunger and for the need to ensure healthy diets for all. So, as Japanese cultural organization, we are very pleased to present to you the lecture and demonstration Bites of Day to celebrate this day together. The program consists of three parts. Firstly, lecture about Japanese rice. Secondly, brief explanation about Onigiri Action Campaign, which you can participate through today's workshop. And finally, Onigiri Rice Ball Making Demonstration. Now, I would like to introduce Mr. Tadao Koike. Koike-san.
はい、皆さん、こんにちは。小池です。よろしくお願いします。
Hello, everyone. I'm Koike.
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
Hi. He is five-star rice meister based in Harajuku, Tokyo. He presents a lecture all about Japanese rice, from its secret deliciousness and how to cook tasty rice. After the lecture, he will answer any questions you have as long as time permits. So please post them in the chat room. And today's interpreter is Mrs. Saki McCarthy.
Mrs. です。
よろしくお願いします。And following his lecture, Ms. Mayumi Uejima-ka, president of Table for Two USA, non-profit organization that conducts various unique and innovative meat sharing programs to right the global food imbalance, will briefly explain about Onigiri Action Campaign. During and after the workshop, you will have an opportunity to be part of the campaign. For details, please listen to her explanation. Uejima-san, いらっしゃいますか?
Hi, nice to meet you all.
よろしくお願いします。 Lastly, Ms. Deborah Samuels. She is a cookbook author and cooking teacher who has lived in Japan for 12 years and specialized in Japanese cuisine. Will demonstrate how to cook two kinds of delicious onigiri rice ball.
はい、では皆さん改めまして、日本時間では今おはようございますなんですけれども、こんにちはですね、東京の、原宿というところでお米屋さんをやっております、小池忠夫と言います。よろしくお願いします。
Hello again, everyone. Well, actually, in Japan, it's good morning. But hello to everyone in the US. I am now in Tokyo, Harajuku, Tokyo.
はい。では早速ですね。まず簡単な自己紹介をします。
So、I'd like to introduce myself briefly.
東京の、原宿という場所なんですけれども、もしかしたら皆さんご存知かもしれませんが、コロナの前はですね、非常に外国のお客様が多い地域でした。
So, I don't know if you know the area in Tokyo called Harajuku. It's a very, very popular area for the tourists. So there were a lot of foreigners coming to see this Harajuku area before the corona situation.
この写真がですね、竹下通りという有名な観光地で、外国の方がたくさん写真に写っているのがわかると思います。
So as you can see in this photo, this is a Takeshita Street, which is very famous in Harajuku, and it's one of the tourist attractions. So you can see a lot of people that are not Japanese in this photo.
小池精米店はこちらです。その竹下通りというところから、歩いて、7分ぐらいのところにあります。
So my company right here is Koike Rice Milling Company, which is about 7 minutes on foot from Takeshita Street.
小池精米店のある場所は、昔はこのように、これ江戸時代の絵なんですけれども、葛飾北斎という人の絵です。ここに写っているような風景が広がっていた場所に小池精米店はあります。
So this one is called a painting, famous painting from Hokusai Katsushika, and this is from Edo period, and it used to be like just like this on Harajuku, in Harajuku.
はい。まああとはですね、自己紹介が長くなると皆さん退屈だと思いますので、もしよろしければ私の Facebook ですね、そちらの方をご覧いただければと思います。
I don't want to bore you with a long self-introduction here, so if you'd like to get to know me better, please connect with me on Facebook, Tadao Koike.
はい、では早速お話しに行きます。
So now I'd like to talk about rice.
はい、今日はお米の、話ですので、まずこちら、もしかしたら皆さん、見たことあるとは思うんですけれども、田んぼの様子です。
So, I'd like to start talking about telling you about rice. And you might have seen this kind of view, but this is a rice paddy. And it's a harvesting season.
ここに広がっている風景、これがですね、お米なんですけれども、でこの左で見ているのが僕で、その右の赤いシャツを着た人が農家さんですね。
So, to the left side of this photo, you can see me. And next to me, in a red shirt, she is a farmer that has harvested this, cultivated this rice.
ではですね、まずこの田んぼに植わっているお米がどのように皆さんがご存知の白いお米になるのかを見ていきましょう。
So I'd like to show you how this, the brown rice becomes a white rice.
まずこのように刈り取ります。
So we harvest the rice just like this.
で、この刈り取った稲穂、これ稲穂と言いますが、稲穂のところにこのようにもみと言いますけれども、お米がついているわけですね。
So on the hand in the photo, you can see the rice ears. So I have pointed out in a red circle, that's where you see this, the rice ears.
すみません、先に言っておきますけれども、日本では、稲を刈るって言うんですけど、稲を刈るときはこの写真のように手でやるのではなく、この後ろに写っている機械で収穫しますので、日本人は今でも手で飼ってるのかというのは思わないでください。
You see myself in the photo. It looks like I kind of like, you know, got all these rice paddies out from the field by hand. But no, we actually use the machines now. So, you know, Japanese people don't really take that rice paddies off that, the field by hand.
はい。ではですね、まずこの稲穂のこの棒のところですね、軸と言いますけど、軸から、もみをまず取ります。
So we get the rice ears off of the branches. We call them core.
でこの取ったもみをですね、この右のもみ殻と その中身の玄米にまず分けます。
So after that, we separate that rice ears to the hulls and the brown rice.
そして先ほどの玄米を今度はですね、ぬかと白米に分けます。これがぬかですね。で、これが白米です。これを精米と言います。
So now we go into milling of the rice, which would separate the brown rice into the white rice and the bran.
はい。では皆さんがご存知なのはこの白米だと思いますが、まず日本人がどれだけお米と深いつながりがあるかということで、このぬかの話をしていきたいと思います。
So, I'm pretty sure that when you think about rice, you would think about this white rice. But in the Japanese culture, we are really deeply involved with the entire piece of rice. So, I'd like to talk to you first about the bran.
はい、まずですね、こちら左の絵が、先ほど見ていただいた玄米になるわけですね。で、茶色いところがぬかになります。
So the left side of the photo, diagram, you can see that the brown rice, and you can see the brown part is the bran.
この茶色い層をですね、こう拡大すると、実はまたこういった3つの層に分かれているんですけれども、僕らはお米を精米するときはこの赤い層ですね。この層を残すようにお米を精米しています。
So you can see the enlarged image of the brown rice, the one piece of brown rice, but that the brown part is actually there are three layers in it. And as a rice mill, we have to make sure that the substarch layer won't get milled out.
この赤いところですね、この層を残すことによって、実はこの層にはうまみ成分がたくさん入っているんですね。だから残すように精米しています。
The reason why is because that's where a lot of umami is. That's where the deliciousness is. So we really have to make sure that that's not going to get taken out.
日本人はお米が好きなので、よりおいしいお米を食べたいと思っておりますので、こういった精米一つとっても、ここまで気を使っているんですね。
So, Japanese people love rice. So, everybody wants to make sure they eat really good, delicious rice. So, as a rice mill, mill company, we really have to make sure that we can deliver that deliciousness.
で、先ほど見ていただいたぬかですけれども、日本人はこのぬかを使って、野菜をつけます。漬物にするんですね。これをお漬物と言います。
So, you're seeing the photos of お漬物, which is the pickled in the bran. So that's what we call お漬物.
はい、すみません、失礼しました。はい。このお漬物が、あります。次に、最近では、このぬかを使ったインクが開発されています。
And recently, there is this new technology. It's the rice ink, which is made out of the bran.
なんで、ぬかがインクになるのか。実は、ぬかにはですね、油が含まれています。日本人は昔、今もそうですけども、ぬかから、油を取って、それを例えば料理とかにも使っているんですね。
So the bran actually has a little bit of fat and it's made into oil. And in Japan, even in the earlier days, people used to use that oil from bran.
で、この油を使って、インクを作ったのが、ライスインキというものでして、例えば日本ですとセブンイレブンのおにぎりの包装紙に使われているインクの、一部が これに使われ、これを使っています。
So, as of now, 7-Eleven has been using the packaging for the omusubi, the rice balls, very popular in Japan, and the packaging has the rice ink on it.
さらにですね、日本人は、こういったぬかを使った、砂風呂というのが日本にはあるんですけども、その砂の代わりにこういったぬかを使った、サウナですね、それで使っている会社もあります。
There are actually hot bath that's with the brand. And you might be familiar with the sand bath, but this is the brand, the nuka is brand, nuka bath.
これをですね、ぬかを発酵させて、暖かくして、その暖かいぬかの中に体を沈めて、要は本当にもうサウナみたいな感じで、リラックスするわけですね。
So, this brand is all warmed up, and you, people would immerse themselves into this bath. And so you're totally warmed up, and you can relax your muscles and your mind and body.
ぬかですね。このように産業廃棄物ではなくって、いろんなところで使われています。それこそ、例えばその畑とかで肥料にも使ったりしています。
So not only this, but we would be using them for the nutrition for that, the rice fields, or some other farms as well. So it's not always going to be that, disposed into that, environment.
はい。では次に今度は白米自体の、炊飯についてお話しします。
Now I'd like to show you about the, how to cook rice.
日本ではお米を調理することを炊飯と言います。
So, cooking rice in Japanese is 炊飯。
その炊飯のための道具として、例えばこちらにあるような、土でできた鍋を使ってで炊飯することがあります。
So these are ceramics, and we often use these ceramics, that are made out of that, the soil in order to make really delicious rice.
ところがほとんどの家庭ではですね、こういった、土鍋を使った炊飯はちょっと難しいなという人が多くて、ほとんどの方がこの左にあるような炊飯器を使っています。
So,you might see donabe in US too, but it's not that easy, as easy as you know, these other tools. So most of the people, even in Japan, would use the appliance called the suihanki, rice cooking.
このように炊飯器自体は便利なんですけれども、最近はさらに美味しく炊けるようにということで、この写真に写っているような炊飯器は、10万円以上するんですね。
So now that many people are more detail oriented about very, they want to make sure, like precisely get the most delicious rice. So the good ones, the suihanki, these appliances cost as much as $1,000.
これから炊飯をするときに、お米、日本の炊飯というのは水をたくさん使えます。炊飯する前にこうやって水の中にお米をしっかりと入れておくんですね。
So, at first, we need to soak the rice. So, we use a lot of water, in fact, in order to make rice. And first step, after washing, is soaking the rice.
先ほど言った炊飯というですね、調理方法は実は3段階に分かれているんですね。一つは、煮るから始まります。でその後蒸す、そして焼くという工程が炊飯の中に一つに含まれているんです。
So actually when we say cooking rice, there are three different steps into itThe first part is simmering, the second part is steaming, and then the third part is grilling.
はい。例えば、東南アジアの方ですと、 お米は茹でるだけなんですね。で、例えばヨーロッパの方ですとリゾットやパエリアというのがありますけれども、その場合は煮込むというですね、一段階だけなんですけれども、日本でやる炊飯というのは先ほど申した3つの炊飯の段、あの3つの熱の座り方があるんですね。
So it's actually pretty unique because other countries would have just one step when we talk about heating the food, heating the rice. So in Southeast Asia, they boil the rice. In Europe, just like risotto or paella, it's stewing or stern stew. Just one step.
はい。では、日本人が炊飯するときの、方法ですね。で、それを簡単に絵にしたのがこれです。
So I'm showing you the diagram of the steps that the rice takes.
左から簡単に説明しますね。
So from the left, right?
まずこちらがですね、お米の中に水を吸水させるというアクションです。
So first, the rice would absorb the water.
で、次に、水を沸騰させて、お米の中から、お米の中の、水分を通じてお米を柔らかくしております。
So now, by boiling, the rice would get a little bit more softer.
で、次に火を消した後も、実は炊飯は続いていて、緩やかに温度を下げることによって、ここでもお米を柔らかくしています。
After that, after the, we turn off the heat, it's still cooking inside of the rice cooker, and it's gradual decrease of the temperature.
で、火を消した後、しばらくこの右の絵のように、しばらく置いておくのを蒸らしと言いますが、これが非常に大事でして、日本では、ですね、赤ちゃんが、泣いていても蓋は取っちゃダメよっていうぐらい、大事な工程と言われています。
So the last part is extremely important and you can't screw this up. It's so important that everybody in Japan knows this saying that even if your babies are crying, or even just one or two, one baby's crying, you cannot, absolutely not open the lid.
はい。このように火の強さと、で、中に入っている水の量によって熱の伝わり方が変わってきていますけれども、それを利用して、日本人は炊飯をしているんですね。
So, as you can see, that, the level of the water inside of the pot really affects the cooking situation. So, utilizing all these different steps is really ideal for rice cooking in Japan.
このように出来上がったお米を日本人は、食べております。今みたいなお話は、土鍋を使っても電気炊飯器を使っても中の仕組みは一緒なんですね。
So here is the beautiful photo of the rice that's cooked already. And what I just explained is the same for 土鍋 and the appliance.
はい。では次にですね、お米の品種の話をしたいと思います。
Now I'd like to talk to you a little bit about the varieties of the rice.
突然ですけれども、クイズです。
Well, I'd like to give you a little quiz.
日本のお米の品種、日本で栽培されているお米の品種は一体どれぐらいあるんでしょうかということです。
How many do you think the rice varieties are there in Japan?
はい、ということで、ちょっと皆さん、考えてみてくださいね。
Please think about which one would be the answer A, B, C, or D.
A が、まあ、100種類よりも下。で、B が 100から200の間、C が200から300の間、で D が300よりも上ということですね。
So A less than 100 varieties, B 100 to 200, C 200 to 300, or D more than 300.
はい。ということで、回答ですけれども、
And here is the answer.
D です。で、そこに書いてありますように、全部で500種類ぐらいあるんですね。
So I wrote in the commentary, there are nearly 500 varieties in total in Japan.
はい。500と言って、そんなにあるのか？皆さん思われるかもしれませんけれども、実は、日本全国、お米はどこでも作っているんですね。
So, you might be surprised that there are so many varieties in Japan, but every part of Japan, there is rice cultivation.
これはですね、小池精米店のロゴマークです。
What you're seeing is a logo of our Koike Rice Milling Company.
これ、この形、皆さん何だか分かりますでしょうか？
Do you know what this shape means right here? I'm pointing.
実はこれ、日本地図なんですね。
It is actually the shape of Japan.
これが日本です。
実は、
これはお米粒で描いた日本地図なんです。
Yes, so this drawing, the painting, is actually done with the rice, the pieces of rice.
しかも、お米の粒の形が一粒一粒違うのが分かります。
And as you can see, each dot looks different from the other.
例えば、こちら北海道という地域なんですが、ここで作られているユメピリカというお米粒です。
So here is ユメピリカ. That's the name of the rice variety in Hokkaido.
例えば、ここは新潟県といいます。ここはコシヒカリというお米ですね。
This one is コシヒカリ variety from Niigata Prefecture.
ここはですね、佐賀県と言いますが、ここは佐賀日和というお米です。
That one is 佐賀日和 rice variety from 佐賀 Prefecture.
このように、まあ、先ほど見ていただいた普段僕たちが食べているお米でもこれだけの種類、各地域でいろんな種類を作っているんですね。
So each area or each prefecture has its own unique rice variety.
小池精米店では日本全国のお米を扱いたいなと思っておりまして、その思いを込めたのがこのロゴマークなんです。
So for us, we would like to utilize every variety that's produced in different parts of Japan. That's our goal. So this is why we made this logo just like this.
しかもこのように食べるだけのお米ではなく、実は加工して日本人はいろんな食品に変えています。
And rice in Japan, we don't just eat it on just like that, but we also process the rice. So you would put the rice into different foods.
例えば、これ皆さんご存知の日本酒です。
For example, sake.
日本人はこのお米からお酒を作っていますけれども、実はお酒を作るお米というのもいろんな品種があるんです。
So, we do make sake in Japan from rice, but there are so many different varieties of sake rice.
Sake rice, それを酒米と言いますけれども、例えば、亀の尾っていうお米だったり、出羽三山っていうお米だったり、そういったお米がありますね。
Yes, so sake rice, you know, it's
Kamenoo,
and Dewa Sansan, and all the other ones that are different from just eating rice.
皆さんもしかしてご存知かもしれませんが、獺祭というお米が、あ、ごめんなさい、日本酒がありますけれども、その獺祭は山田錦というお米で作られています。
You might know 獺祭. It's pretty popular everywhere in the world now. But that is made with 山田錦, which is really well-known rice.
例えば、この写真は、お団子という日本人が好きなお菓子です。
Right here, the left side, it's a odango. These are like really popular in Japan. They are rice cakes.
これは、お米を粉にして作ったお菓子です。
So these are made with a rice powder that's milled in really, really fine powder. And after that, we make these rice cakes.
この右の方にあるのはお餅と言います。
And to the right of it is お餅、餅。
餅はですね、実はこれもまた、あ、これはもち米という米があるんですけれども、その米を潰して、で作ったやつなんですね。
So, もち米, which would probably be known as sticky rice, we make these with pounding the mochi, the sticky rice, and make these mochi.
このもち米もさっきの酒米と一緒でいろんな品種があるんです。
And just like the sake rice, there are so many different kinds of mochi rice.
例えば、宮古金っていうもち米であったり、小金餅っていうお米であったり、出羽の餅っていう米とかで米お米があったりですね、いろんな品種があるんです。
For example, there's 宮古金、小金餅、and 出羽の餅 rice varieties.
はい、すいません。日本人はこのお餅が大好きです。
Japanese people love 餅。
日本人は正月になるとこのお餅を家族みんなで食べるんですね。
And the New Year's days in Japan, like 3 days in the beginning of the year, we all eat mochi.
これはお赤飯と言います。
Right here, it's お赤飯, which means red rice.
これは日本人がすごいめでたい、嬉しい時ですね。ハッピーな時に食べる料理です。
This one is one of the celebration foods in Japan. We eat this when we are happy to celebrate something.
今は食べる、例えばそのお餅であったり、お菓子であったり、お酒でしたけども、食べるだけではありません。
So I just told you about some foods that's made out of rice, but there are things that are not actually something that we eat or drink.
これは出雲大社という神社です。
This one is a shrine called 出雲大社。
日本で非常に古い、そして有名な神社ですね。
It's very ancient and very, very popular shrine.
ここにあるこの茶色い物体がしめ縄と言います。
Right here, the gigantic rope-like thing, this is called しめ縄。
これが、お米の稲ですね。稲のこの稲わらと僕ら言いますけど、稲わらで作られているんですね。
So, we Japanese people make these from the rice paddy. So, these are all made out of the parts of rice plants.
この稲わらを編むって僕ら言うんですけれども、編んでこのようなしめ縄にするんですが、そのしめ縄にするために作られているお米というのもあるんです。
So, there are some rice varieties that are actually made for this, and they would weave these ropes with that.
しめ縄に使う縄という、しめ縄に使う稲というのは、その稲の茎の稲穂の部分じゃなくて茎ですね。茎の部分がすごい長いんですね。そういった長い品種になるんです。
So that the height of these rice paddies are very tall, taller than the other ones. So they have really long stems.
これは日本各地でどこでも見られるお祭りの様子です。
So here is a photo of Matsuri. It's a big celebration day in Japan.
お祭りはこのようなおみこしという神社を小さくしたものをみんなで担ぐことが、たくさん、まあ、なんちゅう、あちこちで行われています。
So everywhere in Japan for the omatsuri, that's usually in the harvesting time, men, you know, some women too, but they would be carrying this portable shrine. This center part is a shrine.
このお祭り自体は日本人が今年もお米がたくさん取れましたということを神様に報告するものでもあります。
So this celebration, one of the purposes is because that people want to thank God that we got really beautiful harvesting season in the year.
このおみこしの上には必ず鳳凰という鳥がですね、祀られています。
And each of the omikoshi, the portable shrine, always has a hoyo, horyo,
ho-o です。ごめんなさい。
ho-o, ho-o. It's a bird god.
この ho-o の口にこういったその年に取れたお米を加えさせて、それで神様に報告するわけですね。
And the ho-o would be carrying this rice paddy.In order to tell the God that we actually made a great harvesting.
例えばこのようにですね、お米を使って大きな絵を描く、そういったことをやっている人たちがいます。
And there are some artists actually that are utilizing that rice paddy field to do some artwork just like this.
これを田んぼアートと言います。
And this is called a tambo art, a rice paddy art.
これはある一定の高さから眺めるとこのように絵が見えるんですね。
So, in order to see the art, you kind of have to be a little bit up high.
これは稲にペンキで色を塗ったのではなく、もともと黄色とか黒とか、白とか、そういう色になっているお米を植えているんですね。
It's not that the artists would be painting the paddies, but there are some rice varieties that would be yellow, black, or white. So,this is very natural colors.
この写真にあるように、下に降りると、実は白い稲であったり、赤い黒い稲であったり、緑の稲であったり、そういうのが交互に植えてあるのがわかるんですね。
And you can see that the lower part could be brown, and the middle part might be yellow, and the higher part might be green. So you can see, like, if you go into the field, then you can see how they're doing it height-wise.
このように、今、お米の品種の話をしていますが、食べるだけではなく、こういった色のついたお米であったり、お酒を作るためのお米であったり、あとは牛を食べるためのお米であったり、いろいろなところで、使われているんですね。
So, I just wanted to show you there are different varieties so that you can make art out of them, or make sake, or mochi, or a lot of different processing going.
ですから、このように先ほど言ったら500種類以上ある。って言いましたけれども、まず日本各地にいろんなお米があって、食べるだけではなくって、加工をするためのお米であったり、こういった目を楽しませるお米であったり、そういったものを数えていくと、まあ、それぐらいになるんですね。
Yes, so 500 varieties. It sounds so many, but actually there are the ones that to eat, to process, and art, and all sorts of different kinds of ways to utilize rice.
ここからも日本人がいかにお米と古くから付き合っていて、その使い方をこういろいろと編み出しているというのがわかると思います。
So you can see Japanese people, because they love rice, and from the ancient time, there are so many ways, and now, even now, they are bringing out different ways, newer ways to utilize rice.
さて、次はこの田んぼですけれども、ちょっと田んぼの見える風景について簡単にご紹介しましょう。
So now I'd like to show you some photos of the rice paddy.
これは佐賀県にある棚田と言います。
So this one is in Saga Prefecture. It's called Tanada.
見てお分かりのように、日本人はお米が大好きなので、どんな悪い条件でも田んぼを作ろうとしてきました。
So, because Japanese people eat so much rice, even when they don't live in the condition where rice could be easily cultivated, they always found ways to cultivate them.
はい。これは実は山の斜面を切り開いて坂道を田んぼにするために階段状に田んぼを作っていったんですね。
So, as you can see in the photo, this one is in the mountains and it's like the stairway. So, the slopes, they made all these stairway like the rice paddy fields.
はい。この石垣、実は機械のない時代に作られたものなので、全部手作業で積んでいきました。
So, I'm pointing at stone walls on the sides of the paddy fields. And these were actually constructed when there weren't any machines to do this. So, people actually made these by hands.
この石垣の高さ、7メートルもあるんです。
Yeah, 7 meters. It's a pretty high.
ま、これを見ていただければ、もう日本人がいかにお米に対する、ね、こうなんていう執念があるっていうのがわかると思います。
Yeah, so by looking at these things that people did, they made impossible things possible in order to cultivate rice.
これはですね、実は沖縄県の石垣島というですね、日本の中で一番西の果てにある、そこで作られている田んぼです。
So, this is in Okinawa, but Ishigaki Island, which is the southwestmost part of Japan.
お米というのは春に田んぼに植えて、秋に収穫します。年に1回だけなんですね。
Rice is harvested only once a year, which comes in the fall season. So rice is planted in spring and then harvested in fall.
ところが、沖縄はすごい暑い地域なので、年に2回お米が作られます。
However, Okinawa, it's really tropical. It's really warm there, so they can cultivate rice twice.
この写真は実は、10月の写真なんです。日本で10月に田んぼでこういった稲が植わってるというのはすごい珍しいんですね。
And this is a view that you would never see in other parts of Japan in October. This photo was shot in October, and this is they just planted a new batch of rice.
年に2回お米を作るということで、日本人はやっぱりお米が好きなんだなというのを分かってもらえると思います。
So, even in Okinawa, they make as much rice as they can because Japanese people love rice.
これは同じ時期の福島県の様子です。
This one is shot in Fukushima Prefecture.
このように 非常に美しい風景が、日本各地には広がっています。
So in the fall season, you get to see this sort of beautiful view of rice paddies, paddy fields.
日本の風景を作り出している。その一つの要素が田んぼであるというのも実は、大きいんですね。
So a lot of the paintings from Japan, the beautiful artwork, express the rice fields often.
日本人はお米を食べるだけではなく、こういった風景の中でもですね、田んぼというですね、田んぼをこう風景の中に入れ込むことによって美しい風景を、作り出しているんですね。
So, Japanese people not only just eat rice, but they appreciate the beauty of the rice fields.
はい。ちなみにですね、先ほどの3枚の写真ですけれども、僕が全部、撮りました。
So, I just wanted to let you know that the three photos you've seen, they were actually shot by me.
僕は、1年に、そうですね、1年に10回ぐらいは原宿から、各地方に行って田んぼを見てきます。
I go out of Harajuku, where my company is, about 10 times a year, and go visit all these rice paddies.
日本は比較的雨が多い地域なんですけれども、私が行くとなぜか、晴れます。
So, you know, Japan is very rainy country. It rains a lot in Japan. However,Whenever I go visit all these rice fields, for some reason, it's always clear sky.
こういった僕のように、そこに行くと晴れるっていう、そういう人のことを日本語で晴れ男と言います。
So, in Japan, some people like me, who makes the weather clear, is called 晴れ男, clear sky man.
ですから僕が行くと農家さんは喜んでくれるんですね。
So when I go visit the farms, the farmers all love me.
はい。では次に、日本人の独自の技、お米をブレンドするということについてお話しします。
Next, I would like to tell you a little Japanese technique of blending rice.
例えば、例えばスコッチであったりコーヒーであったり、食品の中にはより美味しくするためにブレンドすることがあります。
So just like coffee beans or scotch, you would blend some rice in order to make whatever is desired.
お米もですね、実はこのように違うお米をブレンドすることによって新しい味を生み出すことができます。
So, just by doing the, just by blending different kinds of, different kinds of rice, you get the new kinds of taste of rice.
このブレンドをするという技術を持っているのが、私のようなお米マイスターという資格を持っている人なんですね。
And that, the particular masters of rice,just like me, who is actually certified, are in charge of blending this kind of rice, and it's called Rice Meister.
お米をブレンドするには、まずそれぞれの品種の味を知ってないといけません。
In order to, blend the rice, different kinds of rice, correctly or, in a good way, you need to know theThat, characteristics of each rice.
皆さんがご存知のお寿司、お寿司のお米というのも日本のお寿司屋さんはほとんどの店がブレンド米です。
And what you would eat at the sushi restaurants, they are usually blended as well.
ブレンドすることによって自分の好きなお米を作るんですね。
So by blending,the chefs can make the rice they want.
例えば、コシヒカリが 6、笹錦が3、秋田小町が1、こういった割合でブレンドして新しい味を生み出すんですね。
So you could have the ratio of 6, 3 and 1、of different kinds of different varieties.
そして先ほど言ったようにお寿司に向くお米だったり、下にある例えばこういったリゾットに合うお米だったり、今日お話しているおにぎりに合うお米だったり、そういうのを作ることができます。
So by doing that, you get a perfect rice for sushi, risotto, or omusubi, onigiri, that you would be listening to the lecture later about.
さて、今申し上げたようにブレンドすることのメリット、新しい味をすぐに作ることができます。
So benefits of blending immediately creates new taste.
調理人の欲しいお米をすぐに作ることができます。
Allows the chef to achieve the rice he or she seeks.
世界にここにしかない私だけのお米を作ることができます。
And you can make your own unique rice.
この3つのメリットがあるんですね。
So there are three benefits.
さて、日本人がなんでこんなにお米をよく食べるのかというお話を簡単にします。
So I'd like to tell you why Japanese people eat so much rice.
一つには、僕たちの飢えを救ってくれた作物であります。
So it satisfies your hunger and it did satisfy our hunger historically.
お米一粒を植えるだけで千粒ぐらいのお米ができるんですね。
Because when you plant one piece of rice, you get 1,000 of them.
非常に効率の良い作物です。
Very, very effective.
二つ目、お米粒のまま食べられます。
And second, you can eat it as its own.
わざわざ粉にするとかしなくても食べられるというのは非常に便利です。
So you don't have to process it into any powder or anything. It's very useful.
3つ目、おかずがなくてもそのままでも非常に甘くて美味しい。
And it's beautifully rice is delicious and sweet. So you don't even have to have any complimentary dishes.
そして先ほど申し上げたようにお米からはゴミが出ないです。ぬかを使っていろんなことができてましたよね。あのようにいろいろと再利用ができるんですね。
And it's very easy to reuse, so you don't have any waste.
はい。ということで、ちょっと、お時間少し過ぎてしまったので、あとは、簡単にね、お話ししますけれども、私と、外国の方とのお付き合いについてですね。
So, I'm sorry, I'm all going over time right now, but just to briefly show you, this is the relationship I have with the people from other countries.
この写真は日本に来た留学生の方に今日みたいなお米の話をしたり、お米の食べ比べをしてもらった、そういったイベントの様子です。
So this is the event that I had with exchange students that were in Japan, and they were able to compare different kinds of varieties of rice.
弊社は原宿ということで、外国の方が非常に来やすい地域なので、いろんな方がいらっしゃいます。
It's easy for you and everyone from other countries to come and visit us because we're in Harajuku.
こちらの写真はスペインの方で、新聞記者と農家の方が日本のお米のことを知りたいと言ってお越しになりました。
So, these are the people from Spain, and they actually covered my story in the news, and also they wanted to know. Some were from farms in Spain.
この右の写真は韓国の大学生が、農業を勉強している大学生が日本のお米の事情を知りたいということでいらっしゃいました。
And these are the agriculture students from Korea, and they wanted to know the situation in Japan about the rice making.
こちらはポルトガルの、日本食専門の調理人です。やはりお寿司のことを知りたいということでいらっしゃいました。
And he's a chef from Portugal, and he wanted to know more about osushi.
こちらはですね、NHK というですね、テレビ番組に出た時の様子ですが、この女性がベラルーシの方なんですけど、やはりここに書いてありますように、お米の種類って多いのねということで驚いております。
So this is a reporter from NHK, and she's from Belarus, and she was really surprised that there were so many varieties of rice in Japan.
こちらはこのイベントを原宿でやった時に、フランス人の方に参加していただいた時の様子です。
These are people from France.
今私は日本人の日本の和食ですね。和食を勉強する学校の先生をしています。
Also, I am teaching 和食 school, Japanese cuisine school.
その学校で実は半分以上が外国人なんですね。
And more than half of the students there are from foreign countries.
まあそこでは講義は日本語なんですけども、このように外国の方も和食、そしてお米に興味を持っているんだなというのを私もここで勉強しています。
So these lectures that I give are all in Japanese, but these students are really into cuisines that's made Japanese cuisines. So it's surprising.
はい、ということで、このように、私もいろんな方とお付き合いして、よりお米をですね、外国の方に知ってもらおうと。いうふうに活動をしております。
So, I've been doing a lot of things to spread the word about rice, Japanese rice.
こちらの本は僕が書いた本ですけれども、残念ながら日本語版しかないんですけれども、もしご興味がありましたら、どうぞお買い求めください。
So, I'm promoting about my book, and it's only written in Japanese right now, but if you are interested,Please purchase one.
はい、ということでちょっと時間オーバーしてしまいましたけれども、どうもありがとうございました。
Sorry that I went over time, but thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you so much for a very interesting and informative presentation, Mr. Koike. We have a few minutes to ask a question to Mr. Koike.And here is a first question. What is the best rice cooker brand or model? What does Mr. Koike recommend?
炊飯器の種類とか、あとお米のブランドについて、どれが一番おいしいと思われますか？
ですね、まずお米の品種に関して言うと、どれが一番というのはないと思ってます。それは、お米に限らずですけども、お酒とかもそうですし、あとは絵ですよね、絵もそうですけども、それぞれ特徴があって叱るべきだと思っています。
So, according to the variety, you can't really simply say which one is the best. Just like sake or painting art, you know, some people like one, another person might like the other one.
あと炊飯器も実はそれぞれのメーカーによって仕上がりがどのようになるかって違うんですね。だからその仕上がりが固めが好きなのか柔らかめが好きなのかによって変わってきますので、そこはやっぱり、まあ、研究がそれぞれ皆さん研究が必要かと思います。
And also, the rice cooker, it's hard to tell because some people like one and another person likes another one. So you kind of have to do the trial and error.And really research.
Next question. Actually, this question comes in Japanese. じゃあ日本語でお尋ねします。新潟県のコシヒカリをどう思われますか？そこに留学してたことがありまして、よく食べてましたという質問です。
はい、新潟県のコシヒカリはやはりこう非常に美味しいお米の、一つです。で現地で食べると水が非常に美味しいので、やはり美味しく、ご飯は食べられると思います。
So I love Koshihikari. It's delicious. And the local water in Niigata is very beautiful. So when they make the rice there, it's even more delicious.
ただ、最近日本はすごい夏が暑いんです。で、新潟県のコシヒカリは暑さに弱いので、最近はここ2、3年は本当に残念ながら、ちょっとね、品質が下がっていて、農家さんもご苦労されています。
However, recently, it's really hot in summer in Japan, including Niigata Prefecture. So, the quality-wise, it might have declined a little bit in the last two or three years. The farming farmers are having a lot of, making a lot of effort to improve that.
And I think this will be the last question. How did you develop your rice expertise?
どうやってお米に関して それまでのエキスパートになられたんですか？
いや、ですね、一つには、こうお米マイスターの資格を取るときに勉強したというのがあります。
Well, number one, I studied a lot when I was getting certified to become the rice meister.
もう一つは、ですね、あと二つぐらいかな。で、あとさもう一つは、僕は毎朝違う種類のお米を食べていて、食べるごとにこう感想文を書いてるんですね。
And secondly, I eat different variety of rice every morning, so it's different every day. And I make some reports about that particular rice that I eat in the morning.
そして最後に、僕は、先ほど言いましたけども、毎年やっぱり10カ所ぐらいは、農家さんのとこに行っています。そうすることによって、現地で目にしたもの、現地で聞いたものを、やはりこう自分の中で消化して、で、お客様にフィードバックしている。まあ、そういったことも意識してやっています。
And also, as I mentioned, I go visit about 10 different farms, rice farms, and so...When I do that, I get to hear things from them. I get to have the good vision, so I can give my clients good feedbacks about or my thoughts about the particular rice.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you again, Mr. Koike, for a very informative talk. And thank you, Ms. McCarthy, for our wonderful interpretation.Now we would like to move to the second half of the program, Onigiri Action Presentation by Ms. Mayumi Uejima Carr of Table for Two USA. And after her presentation, Ms. Deborah Samuels will show you how to make two types of delicious onigiri.
Nice to meet you all. I have Onigiri Action Mask.And onigiri action t-shirts and ready to jump on to onigiri action. So let me share my screen. And I'm going to talk about what is Table for Two and what is onigiri action. So Table for Two is a nonprofit organization started in Japan and came to the US in 2011. So we trying to tackle the global food imbalance.So in this world, 1 billion people don't have enough food, and 2 billion people have some issues, health issues related to unhealthy eating. So we are trying to tackle this by providing school meals and also promote healthy eating. So one of them is Onigiri Action. It's a fall campaign, and we provide school meals.And we have another program to provide school meals. And the third one is we have Japanese-inspired food education program called Washokuiku. So we teach kids to adults how to eat healthy through Japanese cuisine and culture. So today is an exciting day. It's a World Food Day. So we're trying to think about the food-related issues and take actions.So every year as a nonprofit, we have a World Food Day campaign around this day. So this is the Onigiri Action. So So you learn about rice and then you can do something good by using rice. So how it works is very simple. You make onigiri or buy onigiri and take photos before you eat, and you post on our campaign website or on your social media with hashtag onigiri action. And then for each onigiri photo posted, you can provide 5 school meals to children in need around the world. So it's going until the end of this month. So it's free to participate and it's tasty. And who will donate is that we have generous partner organization. So you can see they're the one donate school meals. Japanese food companies, corporations, and you can see some local rice shops. So last year in 45 days, we have 300,000 onigiri photo posted around the world. And we could bring 1.6 million school meals. And we hope to bring many school meals this year as well. So when you post on a campaign site, you can input your address and you can see the onigiri photo map. I want to show a short video that explaining how you can participate.
Onigiri action. You can take a photo with this onigiri, or you can make a photo like this, or like this, or onigiri mask like this, or crochet onigiri, or you can hug onigiri, or you can be onigiri, or like
So they're my kids who love onigiri, who grew up with onigiri. And there are so many ways to participate. So this is a campaign site and you can see how many photos are posted. So far 94,000 in 2 weeks. And so this is a onigiri photo map. This is the US map, but you can see the global map and you can find all kinds of photos here. And you can get the recipes and also you can apply for hours. And if you purchase those products, you can they can donate a portion for school meals. So let's go back to this presentation slide. So a little bit about rice bowl. Deborah is gonna talk more, but Japanese people eat this for breakfast, lunch, dinner, and snack. And it's easy to make. And it's fun thing is you can be very creative and of course tasty. And why we chose onigiri for this campaign is because we are from Japan, but also onigiri is a symbol of love and care. And it's a rare food made with your hand. So you can put a lot of love when you make onigiri. So we want many people to think about children who need help make onigiri and take actions. So if you go to Instagram, so you can post on your social media just with hashtag onigiri action, you can find many cute photos, creative ones, sometimes with a dog. It looks very delicious and please check them out and post. And as the kids explained that you can, if you don't have onigiri, you can make onigiri pose or draw, like anything onigiri related is okay. So lastly, where the school meals go is that we support children in East Africa, Southeast, and also here in the US. So here in the US, we support schools to have healthier school meals with fresh fruits and vegetables. And in East Africa, each meal looks like this. So if you post one photo, you can bring 5 of them and bring many smiles. So we support these countries. So the impact of school meals is big. By having school lunches in East Africa. So their attendance rate went up, that led to graduation rate went up. And then last week, we had very exciting news that our partner World Food Program, who provides school meals in Africa, so they got the Nobel Peace Prize. So that means it was recognized that school meals, the meals are very critical to bring the peace as well. So your onigiri post makes children's future bright, and I hope you can join this campaign. So there are just a few more ways to participate. So this is actually very useful. If you purchase this onigiri action mask or like this t-shirt, all the proceeds will be donated, and for one t-shirt can bring 30 school meals. If you Google onigiri action t-shirts, you can find that this link. And if you're interested in simply donate, you can text onigiri to this number 44321, so you get the link. And then in this time, it's hard to get together, make onigiri, but like this way, we can have a Zoom video call with your friends and families. So we prepared all kinds of backgrounds and fun onigiri ears and eyes, so you can use those things. And lastly, I wanna show how we can have fun with this Zoom onigiri event. So just an idea. This is a fun way, maybe today, many, so maybe it might be difficult, but you can do that with your friends, passing onigiri. So, and I hope you can join this action. And then now I know you are getting hungry, so I wanna introduce our colleague, Deborah Samuels. She is going to show you how to make delicious onigiri.
Hi everybody from my kitchen in Boston, Massachusetts. I'm all set with my onigiri motifs everywhere. Thank you for joining us tonight. I'm Deborah Samuels. I'm the lead curriculum developer for Washokuiku, the educational program for Table for Two, which Mayumi explained. We go into schools and we teach kids and adults about Japanese cuisine, food education, the shokuiku part, Japanese food culture and nutrition. And we had been doing this hands-on program, but we have quickly switched to a live online cooking classes since March. And one of the first things that we teach the kids is our rice session. And we, of course, teach everybody how to make onigiri. And I'm hoping that many of you have the ingredients today that we listed for you. And we're just going to do a couple of things, and I hope you'll be able to stick with us through that. And we're also going to make the very popular furikake, the rice sprinklings. You can make your own. And it's become very popular in the United States, and you can now find it at pretty well-stocked supermarkets, not just an Asian market. So we're gonna get started, and I'm just gonna push my chair out of the way. I was enjoying Koiki-san's presentation, and I learned a lot. I lived in Japan for cumulatively 12 years over a period of 48. I was a young college student when I first went in 1972. And over the past 48 years, I've lived there cumulatively for 12. So I've had a variety of different experiences throughout my life. And one of them was having, I had a baby when we went to Japan. And then when we came back again to Japan, he was a first grader. And that's where I started my learning about Japanese bento and how to make onigiri, which is a beloved food for everybody. The classic onigiri, which is just the rice and the nori, the roasted seaweed. This is the beloved, iconic comfort food of Japan. I like to explain to kids that it's kind of like the peanut butter and jelly sandwich of America. Everyone had one in their lunchbox. And although this has a lot more depth and meaning through the Japanese culture. So I think most people will know how to make this, but I'm going to very quickly show you how to do it. I'm going to do it the traditional way the first time with my hands. And as Mayumi explained, through your hands is transmitted the love. And so it is generally made with your hands. But when we teach kids, that is generally a giant mess. So we are also using the method that a lot of Japanese men and women use today, which is to line a bowl with plastic wrap so you don't get your hands messed. So let's get started. I hope any of you who are going to be cooking with me are ready with your hot rice. Koike-san also mentioned the reasons why Japanese rice is so unique, but one other reason is that it tastes good cold. And we all know that onigiri are eaten, is eaten for lunch in a bento box or in a picnic, and it's cold food, but the rice is soft and delicious. And so that's another thing about the Japonica variety of rices. So I'm going to get my rice. We have a Zojirushi rice cooker here. Somebody asked about that. And we're very grateful to the Zojirushi company. They've donated dozens of rice cookers to our program. And the important thing is for you to be starting with warm or hot rice. And I will just take some out. A rice ball is about a half a cup. And I'm just going to cool this down a little bit. And now I'm going to turn on my second camera here so that you'll be able to see what I'm actually doing. And if you just give me one sec. Okay. And I will share that camera. All right, there we are. So what I'm starting with is some hot rice, and I'm cooling it down just by spreading it out a little bit. I have a bowl of water and I have salt. And those are the bottom line basics for your plain onigiri. And I'll just very quickly make one to show, and I think many of you probably grew up with onigiri, but for those of you who didn't, you need a bowl of water. You need to wet your hands, not soak them, just wet them. This will keep the rice hopefully from sticking to it. And then you put a little bit of salt on your hand like this. And this helps to flavor the rice just a bit, okay? And then you will take your rice, put it in your hand. My dominant hand is my right hand, so I put the rice in my left hand. And now I'm just going to form a ball like that, just to get the rice starting to adhere to each other, to the grains. And once it is, that's when I'm going to start to form the rice. So I take my right hand, which is my dominant hand, and I'll be making an L or a rooftop here. Just gonna put a little bit more thing. And I'm going to start to press and flip. And you'll see, this is not the best angle under here, but you'll be able to see that the rice is now beginning to form a triangle. Compressing lightly, whoops, and you have a rice, a triangle there. I may end up going back to, you can see my picture here, and I'll show you that you've got the triangle up in this spot. And that is the very simplest form. You don't want to push too hard because the rice will become very mushy. You just want it to stick together nicely. And the very simplest way to also enjoy it is with a piece of nori, roasted seaweed. The rough side goes up and next to the rice, and the shiny side is out and is wrapped around like that. And you have your basic onigiri, okay? All ready to eat, and fine if it stays out for several hours. The nori becomes soft as it adheres to it, so it really doesn't matter that it's going to be cold. So I'm going to set that aside, and now we're going to go to the next onigiri, which is tuna mayo. And this is a combination of tuna, mayonnaise, a little bit of soy sauce, and a little bit of shoyu, a little bit of soy sauce, and I put in a dash of sesame oil. I can see somebody enjoying her onigiri. I hope it's okay, that's wonderful. You're probably all waiting for something to eat. So now I'm gonna show you how we do the onigiri with the kids. This is a bowl. This is my rice bowl. And I line it with some plastic wrap so that will give my hands, leave my hands free. Let me just wipe them off here. And I'm going to get another bit of rice. And I'm going to add that rice to the bowl. And this makes it a little bit easier to actually handle. And again, much cleaner when you're doing it with kids. So I place about a little bit more than a third of a cup of rice into my bowl, and then just make a little indentation in the middle. Now you can certainly do this with your hand, but my heroics for the evening are over. That is, I'm going to do it here so I know it's not going to fall. And then I'm going to just take about a tablespoonful, a little bit more, and put it in the middle in the indentation like this. Okay, I hope you're with me if you're doing this. Just going to get a sip of water. And then I'm going to just add a little bit more rice to the top, just to cover that. And then we will bring this up like a present. We're going to wrap it very easily, and you'll see how nicely this comes together. So you pick up one edge, then another, and then you can lift the rice right out of the bowl. And now you will begin to shape this, but what you're going to do is twist it a little bit, kind of like a gift, and you're going to start to compress the rice, and now you can shape it right into a ball. And as you can see, the rice is not, well, there's a renegade rice from the last one, but it's not sticking to my hands. And I'm able to form this by compressing in the triangle shape and then flipping over like that, compress and flip. And you have your next onigiri, all done, and that is stuffed with your tuna. And sometimes what people like to do, so that if you have a variety of onigiri in a bento box, is they put a little bit of what is inside on the top. And again, you can use your nori and you've made your second onigiri. Okay, and I'll just hold it up here, a little bit off kilter, but there you've got that one. So I'll put that over here. And now we're going to make another kind of onigiri, but this one is kind of a new one. It's called Gochiso Onigiri, and it is kind of a gourmet onigiri. And I will show you. You have the ingredients. You can choose any that you like. Here's my ingredients for today. Oh, I'll just show you this. I'm so crazy about onigiri, I crochet them. So here's my onigiri from last year. We're not eating that today. But gourmet onigiri is kind of like okonomiyaki, where it's anything goes into the rice, and then you form it into a ball. It's, you know, not the restrained type of simple onigiri that you're seeing, but it's more fun. It's very contemporary, and you can make any kind of combination that you want. Again, like okonomiyaki, as you like it. And again, as usual, you start with your warm rice. And then what you're going to be doing, this is kind of like the concept of maze gohan. Maze gohan is mixed rice. So you're going to be mixing ingredients into the rice and then forming the ball, which is very different than takikomi gohan, which is where you cook the ingredients with the rice in a rice cooker. But here you have a little bit more freedom. You can use bacon, eggs, and cheese. You can use curry rice, you know, curry that you make for curry rice. You can mix that in here. There's just any number of combinations. There are some great Instagram sites that you should check out. Just look up Gochiso Onigiri. So today I've decided to use some smoked salmon. Okay. And we're just going to put the ingredients that you've chosen right into the rice. All right. And thinking about Japanese colors, red, yellow, white, black, and green, the colors that are used in Japanese cuisine to form a healthy meal. I'm thinking about also Ayapio, Meidei Taberu, you eat with your eyes, another concept that we teach the American school children when we're teaching about Japanese cuisine and philosophy. I've got some scallions here, like that. And I will say a lot of American kids do find Japanese rice plain. And you may even see people pouring soy sauce on it. And so part of our mission is to help people understand that there are ways to enjoy this very simple food for what it is, but that you can do some additions. And I have here a little bit of arugula, which is a spicy green. And I'm going to mix that in too. And already it's beautiful. You can just eat it like that if you want. And a little bit of cheese. Okay. So we're ready. You want to mix this all together. You want to make sure that your ingredients are not too wet or else it won't hold together. You can always add more rice, which I think I probably will do now, is add a little bit more rice. And we mix it together. And the plastic wrap routine is really the best way to go with this because it will hold everything together nicely. Put that over here. And very often people will use teacups as a nice portion size. It's about a half a cup. And so That's one way not to make something too big so that it is unwieldy. So I'm going to put some of that, my mixture. This is probably enough for 2 to 3 gochiso onigiri. And I'm just going to put it right here in my teacup. I'm going to try not to overstuff it. That is definitely a tendency to do. And as I did before, I'm going to pick up the pieces, the edges, lift it, and as you can see, it's looking pretty beautiful. And if you're going on a picnic, you can leave it just like this. And then start to form it again. As you can see, flip, rotate, and compress. But it's just a very light pressure. It's not a strong pressure, okay? You can make a triangle, you can make a ball, you can make a bale, like a rice bale. Anything goes. So this is your gochiso gourmet onigiri. And the important thing is that you see all the different beautiful bits that you have with this. Again, meidei taberu, you eat with your eyes, and looking at something that's beautiful makes you want to eat it, and Japanese food certainly is that. And there is your gochiso onigiri. So I'll set that aside. And now I'm going to just show you how to make, very simply, furikake. I hope everybody is with me, all right? You can buy furikake, the rice sprinkles, at any shop, but it's also fun to make on your own, and it's actually very, very easy. I have, you don't have to do this now, but I have a little a skillet here that I'm going to heat up. I have a piece of nori, roasted seaweed, that I'm going to fold. And sometimes I leave my seaweed packets open and it gets a little moist. So this is a great thing to do, to use up some moist seaweed. So you're gonna keep just folding your roasted seaweed in half, then in fours, and then again in half, like this. And I'm just gonna get my skillet over here. And I think this is easier to see me doing on a blue board. And then I'm going to cut it again. So you're just cutting it down with scissors, like this, and then cut it here, and then one more time till it's about 1/2 inch by 2 inches. That's about where you are. And then I'm just going to cut it into a bowl in little pieces like this. So some people, when they buy furikake in the markets, they look at the package and they see that there's MSG in it, which is a big deal to Americans. It's not that big a deal to Asians. But still, we don't like to see that in our food. And when you make your own furikake, you don't have it. You just are snipping and putting in the things that you like for it. And this is the very simplest of one. I'm not going to cut it all up, but you get the point for here. And then I have roasted sesame seeds. Put that in. I have some salt, about a half a teaspoon for one sheet of nori. I'll do that. And then I have sugar. And I think the recipe said one teaspoon, but I think a little bit less is fine.
Deborah, are you muted?
Okay, I'm unmuted now? Okay, and let me just go back to finish this up with that, and then I'm gonna show you one more thing, all right? So here we are. You can add black sesame seeds, you can add other things, ao nori. You can also add katsuobushi if you'd like, and you can break it up in here and put it in like this. And then just briefly, you're going to toast it on a low heat in a skillet. And this will toast your furikake and dry it. And you will be able to keep this in a jar for a while, and you don't have to make too much. And I just toast it until I hear the sesame seeds pop, just enough to dry the ingredients. And then it usually is a little bit longer than that, but now I have my homemade furikake like this. And we'll just take it here, put the furikake in here, and then I will take my onigiri and roll it right in the furikake. So you can see the delicious bits of it. It's not toasted enough so it, and it's a little bit big, but it will stick to it if it's a little bit warmer, okay? And so you have your furikake. It's really quite delicious and doesn't have any chemical taste to it. So these are quick ways in which to enjoy your wonderful Japanese rice. And then the last thing I'm going to show you, I'm going to stop the share over there, is I'm going to show you a magic rice trick on how to make the rice ball with two bowls. Some of you may already know this trick without using your hands. I'm just going to wet the bowl just a little bit with some water. One bowl and another bowl. And then I'm going to take the rice. Put it in the bowl, about a third of a cup. And this is a really great, fun thing to do with kids. I call it the magic rice ball trick. And let's hope I don't drop it or embarrass myself in any other way. And you just take it and shake. Shake, shake, shake. And, oops, almost. It's like not opening the rice cooker before it's done. And there you have a perfect rice ball. So, just by shaking it. I do not know why that works, but it does. And it's an awful lot of fun. And kids just love doing this. And this will make a great base for your next onigiri. So that is a quick tricks of the trade, how to make onigiri. I'm happy to answer any questions. We really hope that you'll be able to, if you've made your onigiri with us, we'd like to take a picture of everybody holding their onigiri. So Mayumi, do you want to organize that?
Yeah, if everybody can turn on your video, we would love to take a photo. So you can show your onigiri, but if you don't have onigiri, you can just make onigiri shape or like this. Everybody say onigiri and make a onigiri pose or show your onigiri. Okay, say onigiri. Great. Okay, I think that's great. Thank you so much for joining.
Does anybody have any questions that they would like to ask about making onigiri or Japanese food or anything in particular? Tomoko-san, will you be able to take the questions?
When do you roast the onigiri? When do you roast it?
Where do you roast it? So for yaki onigiri? Yeah, the Japanese have these great grills, but I have made yaki onigiri in a cast iron frying pan. And the trick here is that, or the Teflon pan, is you have to have a very hot pan. You know, it has to be hot and you've got to watch it. And you can brush a little bit of soy sauce on it and put it in the pan, but you have to be careful because soy sauce will burn. But you start slowly. I don't think that there's any oil on it. Certainly in Japan, when they just roast it directly on a wire, there's no oil. Sometimes after they've roasted it, they will brush on miso, like a miso. And another thing we can do here is to, for the last maybe 10 or 15 seconds, stick it under the broiler. Mm. So put miso on it or shoyu or something like that, it will get nice and toasty, but don't leave it, okay? But that's how they generally do yaki onigiri.
Thank you. Okay.
Any other questions that we have? Has anybody made onigiri for the first time tonight? That would be, Anne, great. Awesome, that's great. Well, you all are in California, so you're able to get pretty much anything that you want as far as ingredients are concerned. But now most supermarkets are carrying Japanese rice, which people here call sushi rice, and we need to explain what that actually means. You can get nori anywhere, regular supermarkets, not just Whole Foods. And so a lot of ingredients are really widely available. And we're thrilled about that. Mayumi, do you have anything you want to say at the end? Any other questions?
I don't know. I just got the question where we can buy the onigiri t-shirts. You can search onigiri action and t-shirts. You will come up, the link should come up, but I will try to paste, send through chat too.
Well, we hope that you enjoyed the evening. It was all about rice and all about, I think, something that's very close to the Japanese heart and culture. And no matter how long I've been teaching cooking or learning, I learn something new all the time. And so it was really a privilege to be speaking with Koike-san. And next time I go to Japan, I'm going to hit Harajuku and try his shop.
Okay. So Tomoko-san, are you going to have a poll
Yes, thank you very much, Deborah-san and everyone. I hope everyone enjoying making some onigiri tonight. Oh, just makes me really hungry. Okay, all right. Well, let's turn the mic to the director, Uchida. Just a moment, please.
Thank you very much, everyone. Mr. Koike, Ms. McCarthy, Ms. Uejimaka, and Ms. Samuel. That's all for today. So I hope the event was very informative and have made your mouth water. So the Japan Foundation Los Angeles will continue to present various cultural events online. So please keep in touch and see you again. Lastly, please do not forget to answer the questionnaire, which will be displayed on the screen worldwide, so you can improve our programs in the future. Thank you very much and have a nice weekend.